Good evening, everyone. Who among you here were present during the first two nights? All right. You know, tomorrow I think is a holiday. That's why many are now on their long weekend vacation. Nevertheless, I do believe that the Word of God, despite that we are not, actually we are still a lot, despite that many are not here. I really praise God that many attended. And for those who were not here during the first two nights, I will try to summarize what we have studied in the first two nights. Before we go on with our study tonight, let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Let us pray. Our dear and heavenly Father, we'd like to thank you, Lord, for giving us an opportunity to study your word once again. Lord, may the Holy Spirit be with us. Give us an understanding from above so that we can be able to learn the message that you want to have for us tonight. Bless us, Lord, and forgive us from all the sins that we have committed against thee. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. The title of our message tonight is Heaven Bound. During our first night, we studied about what heaven is. We studied about how God prepared us a home. And we've learned that heaven is a very beautiful place. We have learned that the place is really beautiful in a sense that it is made up of pure gold and precious gems. Where is gem? Wala. Parang yung si gem kanina. And we have also learned that heaven is the best place to live because there we will never experience crying. We will never experience sorrow. We will never experience death. And it is the best place to live simply because God is the one ruling on that place. And when God rules, He rules with love, far from what we're experiencing here on earth. And on the second night, we have learned that in heaven, there will be fellowship with the redeemed people. And there we will worship God. And in heaven, we have learned that worship is is part of our daily life there. And tonight, I don't want to end this series without studying about this very important topic. Next. Tonight, we will answer this very simple question. Who will be in heaven? While preparing for the message tonight, there are times, you know, as I read some books, there are times that suddenly what I'm reading makes me smile. So if I've read something that is very interesting and is telling us a very important lesson, it makes me to smile. But there are also times that as I continue reading, my smile and my happiness are gone. And our topic tonight will show us, will actually tell us why sometimes studying this will make us smile, but it will also make us sad. We will learn about it later. But I hope that we will not leave this place sad. Who will be in heaven? You know, I believe that when God planned about heaven, He wants that everyone will be there. He doesn't want that someone will miss the beauty of heaven. So tonight, we will study who are the kind of people who will be there so that as we stay on this earth, we will be prepared and we will be part of those people. It says in Revelation chapter 22, verse 14, "Blessed are they that do His commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city." It is in the King James Version. Next. Here it is a same text but different version. It says here in Revelation 22, 14, "Blessed are they that wash their robes, that they may have the right to come to the tree of life and may enter in by the gates into the city." Have you seen the difference between the two? Let us go back to the first one. Blessed are... Oh, you read. Oh, next. You read again. What's the difference? On the first one, let's go back. It says, "Blessed are they that do His commandments." And on the second one, it says, "Blessed are they that wash their robes." Is there any difference between the two? Actually, when according to some studies, the King James Version tried to write it in a way that it will be easily understood. But we will try to study more about it tonight. It says in the text, those who will be able to enter into the city are those who wash their robes. So we will try to study about what does this washing of robe means so that we can be able to be part of those people who we can enter the city. It says in Revelation 7:14, "And I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, These are they which came out of great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." This text is actually explaining it more further, what really it means to be washed or to wash our robes. And the text says, "And made them white in the blood of the Lamb." Tonight, the first thing that I want you to remember is that to be in heaven, you know, we cannot actually do something. I mean, it is not our work that will qualify us for heaven. Why? It says here, "Have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." It is not because of what we are doing, but later we will try to study the relationship of the two. And what does it mean to make them white in the blood of the Lamb? It says here, "Through the blood of Christ, believers are justified." It is found in Romans 5:9, "redeemed" in Ephesians 1:7, "brought near" in Ephesians 2:13, "reconciled" in Colossians 1:20, and "purified and forgiven" in Hebrews 9:14-22. These are all things that was done by Christ when He died on the cross. Because of the desire of Christ for us to be in heaven, He do something that humanity cannot accomplish. And through His sacrifice on the cross, we were able to experience the blessing of being part of those people who will be in heaven. But as we will go further, we'll try to study how come that This text is actually telling us that it is already done by Christ on the cross. But why is it that in other translation, it is translated as by doing His commandments? We will try to check on it. We will try to examine what does it mean by that part that says they that do His commandments if Christ already died on the cross and already gave us, and that already gave us a chance to be washed and be part of those who will be in heaven. Let us try to go back into the story of Adam and Eve. And actually, when I try to analyze how things happen during the time of Adam and Eve, it reminds me of a very important lesson regarding what does it mean? What is the relationship between what Christ did on the cross and obeying His commandments? Why these things are essential? You know, if we will try to study the story of Adam and Eve, because of this disobedience, Adam and Eve commits sin. And because of what they did, death became a part of our life here on earth. And because of God's grace, He sent His Son to die on the cross to pay for our sins that started when Adam and Eve disobeyed God. If you will try to use some logic, this is how it happens. Because of disobedience, sin entered earth. And for us to be able to be saved, Christ died instead of us. He paid the penalty of sin so that we can experience life and we can be part of those who will be in heaven. Because of what Christ did, we now have a chance to be free from the penalty of sin, which is death. But the problem is that instead of living a life of obedience, because it is sin that makes us slaves of Satan. Because of sin, we became slaves of Satan. And when Christ died on the cross, we became free. And this obedience is what leads us to be again slaves of Satan. And if we continue on disobeying God, we are actually choosing again to be slaves of Satan. And what Christ did on the cross is actually becoming useless. Remember, if we continue on doing our own will, disobeying God, and trying and continue on sinning, it is actually one way of showing that we did not accept what Christ did on the cross. And if the death of Christ, if the blood of Christ that was shed on the Calvary is what will wash our robe for us to have the chance to enter heaven, disobeying Him is just like not accepting the offer of God, which is heaven that He prepared for us. And if we will study more about it, we will actually discover that those people who will be in heaven, or those people who will only enjoy heaven, are those people who actually follow God's commandment while they are here on earth. Because that same kind of life is the same kind of life that God wants us to have in heaven. Let us continue. In 1 John 2, 3-6, it says here, "And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whose keepeth his word in him, verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him." Verse 6, "He that saith, he abideth in him, ought himself, if also so, to walk even as he walk." The last phrase actually summarizes the whole text. If you are someone who believes that you are abiding in Christ, you will walk the way he walked. You will try to follow the path that he had while he is here on earth. And if we will continue on, it says in John 14:15, "If you love me, keep my commandments." You know, while I was listening to a sermon, the speaker said that in character building, there is no magic. It doesn't happen like I will choose to be good today and I will be good forever. It doesn't happen that way. Character building happens as we continue on with our life. And it says in Revelation 21:7-8, "He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the fearful and unbelieving, and the abominable, and murderers, and whoremongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars, shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." We don't have much time to discuss all the details of that, but the Bible is very much clear that those who have actually the character that shows obedience to God's commandment are those people who will be in heaven. And those who choose to live by the system of the earth will, of course, be of this earth. In Psalms 15:1-3, "Lord, who shall abide in the tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill?" It says, "He that walketh uprightly and worketh righteousness and speaketh the truth in his heart, he that backbiteth not with his tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbor, nor taketh up a reproach against his neighbor." Actually, even though I will not discuss here what is bad and what is good, what is right and what is wrong, I do believe that we all know that. Even though I will not discuss here tonight what it means to follow the commandments of God, I do believe that all of us knows this. But what God is trying to tell us tonight is that we should actually guard our heart. We have to check everything that we are doing. If we will continue on, it says, "Because of sin, Satan was thrust out of heaven, and no man indulging in fostering sin can go to heaven, for then Satan would again have a foothold there." It says that those people who are actually continuing on indulging in sin, and those people who continue to disobey God, they don't have place in heaven. Actually, During the time that that God will bring His people in heaven, those who choose to obey Him, those who choose to live life according to His will, starting that moment, you know, heaven will be a place wherein everything that is of evil will not be part of it. No, I mean, Satan, according to the quotation, will not have any more part in heaven, and also those people who choose the ways of Satan. In Matthew 7:21, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. When I've read this text in one of the book that I'm reading, the book says that words are not enough for us to tell that we truly love God. We might be saying every time that, oh, I love God, praise God, may hallelujah pa. We might sometimes say that, oh, God has been so good, praise the Lord, amen, hallelujah. But if our actions, if our thoughts, if our daily life is not according to His will, those words are not enough for us to be able to be part of those people who will be in heaven. And it says here, if they have not knowingly trampled upon and despised His law on the earth, they will not be taken to heaven to do the same work there. There is no change of character when Christ comes. The character building is to go on during the hours of probation. Day by day, their actions are registered in the books of heaven. And they will, in the great day of God, be rewarded as their works have been. It will then be seen who receives the blessing. Blessed are they that do His commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter into the gates into the city. Let us go back to the previous slide. It says here that those who despise the law when they are here on earth will not be taken there to do the same thing. If you choose the system of the world while we are on the probation stage, your reward will be until here. And just like what I mentioned about a while ago about character building, it says here the character building is to go on during the hours of probation. Day by day, their actions are registered in the book of heaven. And it says here, and they will in the great day of God be rewarded as their works have been. So if your works are for heaven, you will be part of those people who are in heaven. But if your works, if you choose to do things the way it is being done by the world, you will receive your reward according to the reward of those who choose that. We're not saying here that we will be saved by our action, because just like what I said a while ago, it is only through Christ, through what Christ did on the cross. But actually by following God, we are showing that we accepted Him and His offer to be part of those people who will be in heaven. By following Him, by living a life, with full of love to Him and following His commandments. We are showing that we accept what He did on the cross to save us. And last but not the least, it says here in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9, "But as it is written, I had not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man, the things which God had prepared for them that love Him." Again, Christ wants that everyone will be in heaven. When he died on the cross, He is not only thinking of a group of people. He's not only thinking of those who are actually faithful to Him during that time. That is the reason why He died on the cross, to give us a chance to be part of His kingdom, to be with Him forever, to have a relationship with us. Because if He doesn't care for us, He will not sacrifice on the cross. But again, what He prepared for the people of the earth will only be for those people who choose to love Him and follow His commandments. It will not be for those whose desires are of earthly things. It is not for those people who wants earthly treasures than heavenly treasures. If at this very point in time, we are still desiring things of the world more than what God had prepared for us, I do believe that God is still giving us a chance. God is still knocking at the door of our heart and inviting us to be part of His kingdom. You know what was amazing about God is that He is a God full of grace and mercy. I am not saying that of all my life, I have been doing things the right way. Actually, I considered myself as the black sheep in our family. I am not saying that since I was a child, I have been a very obedient son of God. I have been into so many mistakes. There were times that I choose to follow myself than to follow God. There are times wherein I choose to live my life the way the world wants it, which is opposite to what God wants me to live. But just like what Paul says, it is not in one of his letters, he says that it is not, the text goes like this, it is not something that I have already achieved, but one thing I keep on doing, and that is to forget what is behind and strain for what is ahead. Tonight, it might be that in our past life, we choose to live according to the system of the world. We choose to disobey God. But God is telling us tonight that no matter how we live in the past, if we will choose tonight to accept Him, He will give us the chance that we need. I do believe that if we will choose tonight to live our own life and choose to live a life according to the will of God. God will be very much open to accept us just as we are. And I do believe that day by day, Christ or God is knocking at the door of our heart to remind us, to tell us that still there is a chance. Time will come that our decision will be final. So I hope that as this very moment when we are still hearing the voice of the Holy Spirit asking us to accept Christ in our life, let us not stop from listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Let us give time to the invitation of our God. And let us try to ponder upon what He is actually trying to tell us. Let us not waste our time in missing that voice from the Holy Spirit. Tonight, as we end our study about heaven, may it be that more than anything else on this earth, we will be desiring to be part of the kingdom of God, to be part of those people who will be in heaven, who will experience to live with Christ, to live with God eternally in a place where we will never experience the sadness that this earth that this earth has given us. So as we continue on with our life on this earth, may we live a life which is aiming not of the things of this earth, but aiming or desiring to be in heaven with God. May it be our earnest desire to be part of those people who will sing gloriously as we enter the gates of heaven. May God bless us all.